Welcome to Whirlow. You're all very welcome. And just in case there's anybody here that I've not met, my name's Joy and I'm the chaplain here. A wonderful privilege. We meet in the name of God, creator of the universe, source of true humanity, mother and father of all.
Amen.
We meet in the name of Jesus, word made flesh, saviour of fallen humanity, lover of all.
Amen.
We meet in the name of the Holy Spirit, Lord and giver of life, midwife of new humanity, inspirer of all.
Amen.
Come then, eternal God,
be present here, befriend us here, renew us here.
In this time of silence, I invite you in particular to perhaps recall over the last few days those times when you have been extremely busy, perhaps distracted. How did you feel? And where was God for you in those times? And if in those times you felt God was distant, a verse from the psalm for today, Psalm 130, may be of some assurance. If you should number the times we strayed from you, O beloved, who could face you? Yet you are ever ready to forgive, that we might be healed. Lord, hear our prayer and change our lives until we illustrate the grace of the God who makes all things new. Amen. The Gospel for today will be a reading. A story that will be familiar, I'm sure, to many of you here. It's, put it in context, it's after Jesus has appointed 70 others to follow him and sent them out. It's where he's been asked by somebody, who is my neighbour? And tells that amazing parable of the Good Samaritan. And then we come to this passage at the end of John 10. Now as they went on their way, he entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks. So she came to him and asked, Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me. The Lord answered her, Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her. This is the word of God. Just note what that passage has generated eternally in you. It may have been sympathy for Martha. Maybe questioning Jesus' response. Maybe a longing to be Mary at the feet of Jesus. Maybe all three. But I suggest that your, and this is your personal response to that passage, will say something about what's going on in your life at the moment. And how you are relating to God, and you feel God is relating to you in that situation. Do you identify with one of those people in that passage more than another? To Martha? To Mary? Or even to Jesus. Do you feel a compulsion to identify with Mary or Martha? What does Mary represent to you, for you? What does Martha represent for you? Moment quiet as you ponder that and note what's going on in your gut. So often I've heard this passage preached on as a way to compare an active life with the so-called spiritual life. It's made me feel guilty if I'm too busy. It's made me feel guilty if I feel I'm not spiritual enough. But what if this passage could be read in a different way? What if here Jesus is not saying there's a choice between being contemplative and active? What if there's an invitation here just to look at ourselves in any one situation, to stop and to just consider, where is God for me? Because you see, I don't believe Martha was not spiritual. I don't believe that Martha did not have time to listen to Jesus. And I say that Because if you turn to John's Gospel, at a traumatic time in Martha's life, her brother was dead. And she knows that if Jesus had come earlier, he may well have been able to heal, he would have been able to heal Lazarus, her brother. And when Jesus does arrive after the death of Lazarus, her brother, Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die." And then he says to Martha, "Do you believe this?" And her response, "Yes, Lord. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God." Almost the same words that Peter responded when Jesus asked his disciples, "Who do you think I am?" Yet it's rarely we hear Martha being expounded as an apostle, as a disciple of Jesus in the same way as Peter. Martha must have listened deeply to Jesus to recognize him as the Messiah, the Son of God. So I wonder whether at this moment in time in that household, both Martha and Mary were being invited to just stop and consider, where is Jesus for me today? Perhaps there's another way of considering this. And I'll just share this with you. It's on the blog if you want to go back to it on our website. Before we go into the time and silence and the time for you to go deeply with Jesus this morning. Jesus comes to visit and Martha gets annoyed. Sometimes this is interpreted as an indictment against busyness. But perhaps it is more a warning against our tendency to become anxious when we watch another person come home to themselves. Might Martha feel her own security threatened, watching Mary come home to herself with Jesus? How easy do you find it to delight in someone else's homecoming? Yes, just take this time to consider, where is Jesus in you this morning, or in whatever you may be going back to from here? And where do you feel most at home? And how do you react when you see others coming home to themselves? Yesterday was the feast of St. Francis. And St. Francis, during his life, often had times where he felt pulled between action and prayer. And he would ask those that he recognised and accepted their advice, do I preach or do I pray? And it helps me when I think of saints like that who had those same tensions in their life. But if ever any of you, and some of you have, been to the Portiuncula, which is a Franciscan convent in Clay Cross, there the sisters in that retreat house have divided it into a Mary side and a Martha side. On the Mary side are five rooms, hermitages where you pray. You can book in there for a retreat. And then there's an airy atrium, and then on the other side of that atrium is the Martha side, where the library is, the study can take place, the kitchen and the dining room. And what is wonderful that I found out about those nuns is that they offer that place to enable people to recognise the balance between being a Mary and being a Martha. You need both. And I think that for some of us who might say, oh, I'm a Martha. Oh, no, I'm a definite Martha. Okay, you may be in some ways, but what is that preventing you from doing or being? And others may say, oh, I'm a Mary. My place is to pray. That's fine. But what if you just identify totally with that? What might that be preventing you from being to other people? I just leave that with you as we come to our prayer of thanksgiving and our prayers of concern before we share in bread and wine together. And here again we get a balance. If you like, it's almost like prayer of action, because heaven is here and earth. And the space is thin between them. Distance may divide, but Christ's promise unites those bounded by time, those blessed by eternity. Let heaven and earth be glad.
Let the whole earth cry in glory.
Heaven is here and earth, and the church above and below is one. All the saints from far back are here, including St. Francis. And those who left us not long ago, only sight prevents us from seeing them. Let heaven and earth be glad.
Let the whole earth cry glory.
Heaven is here and earth, and the Lamb who made them is present. The Lamb glorious on the throne sits beside us. The Spirit of God makes her resting place among us. God inhales the breath of our prayers. Let's pause. As we bring either out loud or in the silence in your heart, those concerns that you may have, perhaps for those who you know are distracted by life at the moment, a friend, a neighbour, bring them to Jesus and ask for his peace for them. Now bring before Jesus those who are distracted by the responsibilities of leadership in whatever arena that might be. Local government, national government, church, organizations. Bring them to Jesus. And finally, bring yourself again. Perhaps something that's been raised during this morning as you've reflected. Is there something that you know could so easily distract you from recognizing and experiencing the true love of God? God inhales the breath of our prayers and spreads a table for us. Let heaven and earth be glad.
Let the whole earth cry glory.
Lord, you have gathered us together. Make us one in you, one in heart and mind, one in thought and deed, to serve you and to do your will. Lord, we offer ourselves to you. As we offer this bread and wine, as the grain is gathered from the fields to make one loaf, and as the grapes are gathered from the hillsides to make one wine, may we be one in you. Among friends, gathered round a table, Jesus took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and said, "This is my body given for you." Be with us, Lord, in the breaking of the bread, in the breaking of our lives, in the breaking of our hearts, in the breaking of our hosts. Be with us, Lord, in the breaking, for you alone can make us whole.
And the next prayer we'll say when we come to eat bread together. At the end of supper, Jesus took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them and said, "This cup is the new relationship with God, sealed with my blood. Drink it to remember me." Be with us in the outpouring,
in the outpouring of our hopes, in the outpouring of our hopes, in the outpouring of our troubles. Be with us, Lord, in the outpouring, for you alone can make us whole.
You, Lord, are the bread of life. Let this bread be life-giving. Let this bread be a means of growth. Let this bread be for our strengthening,
that in receiving this bread we may be one with you. You, Lord, are the true vine. Let this wine be for our refreshment. Let this wine be for our renewal. Let this wine be for our joy, that in receiving this wine, we may be one with you. Say the final prayer together. Lord Jesus Christ, you have put your life in our hands. Now we put ours in yours. Take us, renew us, remake us. No longer is what we have been as important as what with you we can now become. Amen. May you go from this place, and then you go with Jesus, who has taken you, who renews you, who remakes you, so that we can all become what we are meant to be.